Ladies and gentlemen, this is the main event of the weekend. The best team for Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl is here. And now, it's time!
I am very excited to finally arrive at these best teams. It's always a highlight for me when I can put one together for an all-new set of games. What's even more exciting is that despite these games being relatively faithful remakes of the originals, there's a few massive pluses here that change everything. Instead of just recycling my Diamond and Pearl best team, I was able to come up with a few new Pokemon for the team thanks to the many powerful TMs that are easily available. And the fact that the Grand Underground made certain Pokemon significantly easier to get and use. This team is absolutely the best you can use by just playing the base game. And it's so good, I honestly think like 3 Pokemon can get you through the whole game. Now, of course, we still have a full team of 6, but I can't help but think that this is the strongest best team of all time. Now, before we get into the team, I would like you guys to share with me what you think the best team truly is for Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl. There's always people that don't completely agree with me, and I'd like to get a full team of 6 out of you guys in the comments so I can really compare and contrast from what I decided on. That's enough explaining, however. Let's get into the video everyone has been waiting for. The best team for Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl. So, starting off this best team is of course our starter Pokemon. It's quite funny honestly. No matter how much things change, they also stay the same. I chose Infernape, as even in this slightly different and updated Sinnoh region, it reigns supreme as the best option. While there is more variety behind the fire typing in these games, if only just a little, none of them quite light the candle like our favorite Fire Monkey. It's still as strong as ever, with 104 in both of its attacks, and even better, 108 speed. And man, it's just nice to have access to this thing. I really missed it in Sword and Shield, and the fact that it's back with even more power now is awesome. As is the usual with starters, there isn't much else to go over, so let's get into the moveset. So here we go. Our first moveset today begins with Close Combat, and is followed by Flare Blitz, Acrobatics, and Rock Slide. Alright, it's Close Combat. Close Combat is, of course, the best fighting type move Infernape is rocking out with from its pool. It's learned upon evolving into Infernape, so Mach Punch and Power Up Punch are the moves to go with for fighting type stab. I have Brick Break on a Pokemon later, which is why I didn't suggest that while you waited. The next move is Flare Blitz, learned at level 68. Except, we're not gonna wait until then. Instead, we will use the hard skills we find in the underground to relearn Flare Blitz in Pastoria City. Now, if you're less interested in recoil damage, Flamethrower is also super viable for Infernape, and you can buy that TM at the Veilstone department store. Next up we have Acrobatics. It's learned at level 52, which is super later on, probably around the 8th gym. Thankfully, you can get the TM for Aerial Ace on Route 213, so use that until Acrobatics comes around. Finally, we have got Rock Slide, a TM you can either find in Mount Coronet or in the underground from a cellar or in a big glacial cavern. Your best bet is probably just to keep looking around for a cellar down there. It's not too terribly difficult. You can always run Rock Tomb until then, of course. So, with these moves, Infernape is able to do well against Rourke's entire team, Gardenia's entire team, Maylene's Lucario, Crasherwick's Quagsire, Fantina's Drifblim, Byron's entire team, Canis's entire team, Volkner's Ambipom, Saturn's Bronzor and Toxicroak, Jupiter and Mars's entire team except for Skuntank, Cyrus's entire team but like, be careful you know, Barry's entire team, Aaron's entire team except for Drapion, Bertha's Golem and Sudowoodo, Flint's entire team, Lucian's Bronzong and Medicham, and finally, Cynthia's Roserade and Lucario. Just look at what Infernape can do in the gym battles, and a pretty large amount of the late game battles as well. We'll have plenty of moves coming up that can handle the remaining Pokemon. But seriously, when we are already covering this much with just our starter, you know the team's gonna be really good. Alright, so from one usual suspect to another, this best team welcomes back another Pokemon emitted from Sword and Shield that was a longtime member of many 4th gen best teams. The best bird out there, Staraptor. They did this thing very dirty by not having return in BDSP, as that would have been hands down the best normal type move it could use. But unfortunately, that wasn't that case. You can pair that fact with Fly no longer being necessary, and Staraptor loses some of its usefulness in the eyes of some, sure. Well, I still really respect and like this thing a lot, and I wanted to include it on the team since it's a very early Pokemon to get and brings great backup to some of the best things Infernape can do. Truth be told, I like to often put these best teams in the order of when you get certain Pokemon, as well as how obvious they are to be included. I actually picked Staraptor last for the squad because I realized something great. We were in a position where the team I built was so good, I could stick a Pokemon with a pedigree like that of Staraptor on it, and it could almost be an afterthought. You catch Starly at the start of the game, and at level 34, your Staravia will evolve into the top bird. Let's take a look at the moveset here. It's pretty fun. Brave Bird, Close Combat, U-Turn, and Steel Wing are the moves that Staraptor has going for it in this playthrough of Sinnoh. A very vintage moveset for it, with a splash of sort of necessary coverage. Brave Bird leads off the set as a move learned at level 49, but Aerial Ace and Wing Attack are both viable moves to use leading up until then. Next is Close Combat, which, just like Infernape, is learned upon evolving in the Staraptor. Who doesn't like a bird that can just pull up and start kicking and punching? It doesn't make much sense, but whatever. Live your best life, Staraptor. Next up is U-Turn, which is a TM purchased in the Veilstone department store. If you want something to deal with psychic types, U-Turn is going to be the move for you. Who doesn't like a little pivoting action too? We wrap up the moveset with Steel Wing, a TM procured on Route 209 that serves as coverage for fairy types. You can never have enough of that, right? Now with these moves, Staraptor is able to do well against Gardenia's entire team, Meilin's Metatite and Machoke, Byron's Steelix and Bastiodon, Canis's entire team, Volkner's Ambipom, Saturn's Toxicroak and Kadabra, Jupiter and Mars's Perugly, Cyrus's Weavile, Barry's Snorlax, Roserade, Empoleon, and Heracross, Aaron's entire team except for Drapion, Bertha's Sudowoodo and Golem, Flint's Steelix, Lopunny and Infernape, Lucian's Draffarig, Medicham, Mr. Mime, and Alakazam, and finally, Cynthia's Roserade and Lucario. Staraptor comes through against some psychic types thanks to U-Turn, and a couple of ice types with Steel Wing and Close Combat. There's a ton of crossover with Infernape, but like I mentioned earlier, really Staraptor was just here to fill a spot, because as you're about to see, this team is just so good. Let's keep it rolling with a relatively obvious Pokemon, this time being the bouquet Pokemon, Roserade. It only got better and more relevant with these games, as its grass poison typing became all the more invaluable due to the fairy typing's newly found prevalence in Sinnoh. You can capture Bidoof really early in Sinnoh, which is actually so early it can come through in the first gym battle, which is necessary if we want some super effective stab against Rourke instead of Chimchar's non-stab power-up punch. You could always evolve Chimchar into Monferno, but Bidoof's also just as good. So once you have Bidoof, you just gotta evolve it by leveling up during the day with high happiness, and then evolve into Roserade with the wonderful shiny stone. Oh, speaking of that, you'll need to find a shiny stone. You can grab one in either Iron Island, which is definitely a long way off from when you originally got Bidoof. But there is also a different means. I had some slightly incorrect information in my top 10 Pokemon to use in BDSP video. As it turns out, there is only one place in the Grand Underground that you can find a shiny stone, and they make you wait until you're in the northeastern part of the underground, which I'm pretty sure is the postgame. So if you want to find one really early, you'll need a team of Pachirisu trained to level 11 at the very least, and with the ability Pickup. You'll have to put in a little bit of work to eventually find one by knocking out wild Pokemon, but it's well worth the work and isn't actually as time consuming as I probably made it sound. I'm going to be writing this from the perspective of finding one ASAP with Pachirisu. But I mean, hey, using Roselia for a long period of time is okay, I guess. You're really missing out if you don't get that 125 base special attack as soon as you could though. It's time for the moveset. Let's see what all that power is working with. We've got Giga Drain, Sludge Bomb, Dazzling Gleam, and Shadow Ball coming together for Roserade's moveset today. The leadoff with Giga Drain is probably a little different than you'd be expecting. It definitely isn't hard to get Petal Dance, which is of course stronger, though it comes with being locked into the move and ending up confused, while Giga Drain can still hit hard and recover health. It just made more sense to me here, and its TM is located on Route 209, but you'll need Surf to go and get it. The next move up is Sludge Bomb, found in the Galactic Warehouse, which you're not exactly accessing until after the 6th badge, so it'll take a while. There is a lack of poison moves prior to that, but it's no big deal. I mean, there is Poison Sting after all, though we've got plenty of steel moves that can handle fairy types if need be. Then we have Dazzling Gleam and Shadow Ball, with the former available for purchase in that Veilstone department store, and the latter is found on Route 210 outside of Celestic Town. More coverage and good stuff at that. Cynthia's team is gonna be shaking in their boots. Roserade is gonna use these moves so it can do well against Rourke's entire team, Gardenius, Cherubi, and Turtwig thanks to Poison Sting, but leave her to the last two Pokemon. Meilin's Metatite and Machoke, Crasher Wake's Quagsire and Floatzel, Fantina's entire team, Canis's entire team, Volkner's Octillery, Saturn's Kadabra, Cyrus's Honchkrow and Weavile, Barry's Heracross, Aaron's Heracross, Bertha's entire team, Flint's Drifblim, Lucian's entire team except for Girafarig, and finally Cynthia's Spiritomb, Gastrodon, Milotic, and Garchomp. Do you guys see how impressive Roserade is? It does so much in every important battle for the most part. If you pair it with Infernape, you've practically gotten everything covered that you would need to worry about. We've got more Pokemon to go through, but seriously guys, this team is pretty freaking strong. We'll open the second half of our team with the representative of the water type. I went over the few good ones that are there in Sinnoh, and I ended up deciding on the always powerful Gyarados. It's just another Pokemon you can get super early at the start of your journey, as the old rod is obtainable just outside of Jubilife. You know, just in case you weren't aware, you can pretty much pull out the old rod anywhere, there's a body of water, and boom, Magikarp City. It'll get to level 20 and evolve into Gyarados, or rather the experience share being on all the time will get it to level 20, since you're not really going to be using this thing in battle until it does evolve, trust me. Gyarados is a classic example of strong physical power in a typing without much representation like that in the Pokedex. Floatzel and Azumarill are the only other relevant options as physical water types available, and I already have a fairy type that you'll see shortly on this team. As for Floatzel, while it might be a favorite for many of you, it's not one for me. At the very least, Gyarados has some better defenses, and is a stronger attacker as well. The only thing Floatzel really has on Gyarados is speed, but the atrocious Pokemon will be fine not being that fast. Trust me. How about we get into this strong fish's move pool, eh? So, this Gyarados moveset is Waterfall, Ice Fang, Crunch, and Dragon Dance. This one is pretty quick, with Waterfall learned at level 21. Ice Fang when you use a hard scale to relearn it, and then Crunch at level 24. There's a decent amount of coverage among those moves, especially with the water type. It's a good one to get usage out of. The set closes out with Dragon Dance, learned at level 36, and bringing an opportunity to set up speed and attack, which can make Gyarados pretty damn good against everything. As you can see from this set as well, there is no flying type moves. Why in the world is Gyarados a flying type anyway? I understand from a thematic perspective why, but like, what's the point when you'll only give it Hurricane and Bounce? That's my random mystic thought for the video. You know what's also another mystical thought though? Osile, the Genshin Impact god that looks like Gyarados. In fact, I actually have a Genshin channel that I've been waiting to reveal, and we actually just happened to hit 10k. So if you guys like mysteries, theories, and rabbit holes, go check out Teyvatnery. Link will be in the description below. Now, using these moves, Gyarados is able to intimidate Fantina's entire team, Byron's entire team, Saturn's Kadabra and Bronzor, Jupiter and Mars's Golbat and Bronzor, Cyrus's Honchkrow and Crobat, Barry's Staraptor, Roserade and Rapidash, Aaron's Beautifly and Vespiquen, Bertha's Hippowdon, Golem and Sudowoodo, Flint's entire team except for Lopunny, Lucian's entire team except for Medicham, and finally Cynthia's Roserade and Garchomp. In the second half of your gym challenge, Gyarados definitely shows up, and that should be appreciated. It may not be super important to have water in Sinnoh, but you never want to sleep on this power. So remember how I mentioned we had a fairy type coming up? Well, here it is. It's Clefable. If you've seen like at least a quarter of my BDSP videos leading up to this best team, then you'll know I have been singing the praises of this original fairy Pokemon. The changes made in BDSP have resulted in a fantastic set of circumstances for this thing. Now, that being said, I'll make this as clear as I have in my past videos. On this team, Clefable will probably be the hardest, most annoying Pokemon to actually get your hands on. Cleffa is available on the first accessible floor of Mount Coronet. And of course, you'll need to level it up with some high friendship in order to get Clefairy. Now, the issue here is in finding a Moonstone. It isn't available anywhere to just pick up, so you either need to find one in the underground mining, which could take a long while, or you can find a Cleffa holding one. I'd suggest getting a Pokemon with Thief and just trying to steal one if the initial Cleffa you catch isn't holding one already. It'll save you time. So yeah, go ahead and evolve into Clefable as soon as you want, and you've got a pretty good fairy type with more coverage than it knows what to do with. I'd be remiss if I didn't mention Magic Guard either. That's always really important to bring up when talking about Clefable. You might like Gardevoir more on this spot potentially, and it definitely is a viable option too. But I couldn't shake the fantastic move pool of this one. Speaking of, let's waste no more time and hop into that moveset. Clefable is bringing Moonblast, Ice Beam, Thunderbolt, and Psychic. It's a cavalcade of coverage here, with tons of other moves I could have gone with too. Thankfully, most other things were already taken care of by the rest of the team. So with Moonblast, you'll be hard scaling that back on in Pastoria. As for the next three moves, you can buy them all at the Veilstone Apartment Store. Guys, do you really understand how many times I've said that in this video? And I swear this video is not sponsored by the Veilstone Department Store. Just because they have well over a dozen amazing moves for purchase at an incredibly fair price doesn't mean they paid me off to say that. And after all, I am a Game Freak shill and a bootlicker. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'll be spending my billions of PokéDollars on a nice 5-course meal in Pastoria City. So this coverage machine is going to do well against Meilen's Machoke, Crasher Wake's Gyarados and Floatzel, Fantina's Drifblim and Gengar, Canis's Sneasel, Volkner's Octillery, Saturn's Toxicroak, Jupiter and Mars's Golbat, Cyrus's entire team, Barry's Empoleon, Roserade, Staraptor and Heracross, Aaron's entire team except for Drapion, Bertha's Golem and Hippowdon, Flint's Drifblim, Lucian's Medicham, and finally Cynthia's Roserade, Spiritomb, Milotic, and Garchomp. So yeah, Clefable and that coverage. It does a ton. It joins Infernape and Roserade in bringing down an awful lot of Pokemon. And basically everything feels like it's taken care of, with the exception of electric types. Don't worry though, because I've got something for that coming up. We have now reached the final member on this team. And it's such an old favorite of mine. It's been far too long since I could include it on a team. And here we are, bringing it up in a region where it was once damn near impossible to reasonably use. The last time I brought up Snorlax and Sinnoh, you guys let me know it was a miserable endeavor finding Munchlax. Well, it seems like not only did I take that fact to heart, but so did Ilka when putting Pokemon in the Grand Underground. After you've obtained the ability to use Defog, which comes with defeating Crasher Wake, you'll start to see some new Pokemon appearing in a few choice caves of the underground. You'll soon discover one of those new Pokemon is Munchlax, meaning Snorlax is no longer one of the hardest Pokemon to get your hands on in this region. It was pretty exciting for me to see, and considering you guys, most familiar with the Best Team series, know how much I love to close out teams with a strong normal type. This was just a match made in heaven. Munchlax is another Pokemon that will evolve with some friendship, giving you Snorlax as soon as you've proven your ability to love this fat boy. Maybe give it a ton of poffins and snacks and whatnot. Snorlax is a specially defensive wall with some solid physical attack, making it a good partner with Gyarados, which is in the same boat, stats-wise. We've got so much first-gen power making up this second half of the team, and I'm sure there's going to be a lot of you who appreciate that. So, one last time for this video, let's get right into the moves. The final moveset of the day is going to be Body Slam, Brick Break, Earthquake, and Heavy Slam. Snorlax gets great stab damage out of Body Slam, the first move on this set. It's learned at level 28, and boy does it bring the pain. Have you ever thought about getting Body Slammed by a Snorlax? It weighs a ton, and it can paralyze stuff and whatever. So, how about Brick Break? The TM for that is found very early on in Orberg Gate, and it being on Snorlax wraps back around to what I was talking about earlier with Infernape not getting it while waiting for close combat. Then we have Earthquake, a TM found amongst a den of Gible in the Wayward Cave. You can use your bike to find it, and then slap it right on Snorlax. Finally, we have Heavy Slam, which is sure to be a good move to pull out, considering this fat boy is well over 1,000 pounds in weight. Ice types, rock types, fairy types, you're all in a world of trouble when you feel the ground shaking, because Snorlax is coming to slam on you. So our final Pokemon is using its moveset to do well against Byron Steelix and Bastiodon, Canis's entire team except for Medicham, Volkner's Raichu, Luxray, and Ambipom, Saturn's Toxicroak, but watch out, Jupiter and Mars's Poruglian and Skuntank, Cyrus's Weavile, Barry's Empoleon, Rapidash and Snorlax, Aaron's Drapion, Bertha's Golem and Sudowoodo, Flint's entire team except for Drifblim, Lucian's Mr. Mime, and finally, Cynthia's Lucario. That's it. I'm pretty sure we've taken care of every single Pokemon that every important trainer has in these games. It's super impressive. And as always, you love to see it. Shout out to Snorlax for bringing that last bit of power. Good looking out, big boy. Alright guys, that is going to do it for the long-awaited best team for Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl. The squad came together quite well, and while the games are definitely some of the easiest in this series thanks to the easily obtainable good moves and the experience share being on all the time, it's still impressive that perhaps only 3 or 4 Pokemon are really needed to get through a whole playthrough. I really want to see what you guys think the best team is though, if you don't entirely agree with me. I think because of how easy things are, you can interchange certain Pokemon. So I'm interested to hear from you guys. For now though, that's going to do it for this best team. But don't you guys worry, there are still several teams coming out this month for Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl, including the alternate starters, and of course, the worst team. Keep an eye out as the weeks go by, and keep it here on Mystic Umbreon for more great BDSP content. Also, next week, I'll be streaming my best team playthrough for a whopping 12 hours, so be sure to show up. You don't want to miss it. Hey guys, thank you for enjoying another Mystic Umbreon video. It's exciting times for the Pokemon franchise, and I look forward to the coming months where it just keeps getting better. I want to give a huge thanks to my phenomenal team, and for the amazing art done each week by Danny the Demon. I couldn't do all of this without them. If you guys are wanting some more bite-sized Mystic Umbreon content, please check out my TikTok, where I upload daily, as well as the Mystic Umbreon Shorts channel. If y'all enjoyed the video and want to see more content like this, be sure to leave a like, subscribe, and hit that notification bell. Be sure to leave a comment too, it really helps us out. I think it's time to wrap this up though. I'm Mystic Umbreon, and I'll see you next time with some more amazing Pokemon content.